new future that God has for each one of us. But as we approach this subject, I just want to make that same point, that this book is not a textbook in which we can look at a certain chapter and say, aha, that's the chapter, and it's going to give us all the answers about the future. It does not do that. And I hope we'll develop an understanding of why it doesn't do that as we begin to go through the subject, and certainly this morning. Because I want to begin, I'm not even going to begin at the beginning this morning. I want to begin before the beginning. Is that possible? Because Genesis 1 says, in the beginning, God created. So actually there must have been a time before the beginning, wasn't there? Because God does not have a beginning. So before God created, God was. He was there. As God. And there came the point, yes, when God decided and established in his mind, first of all, the plan to create. But prior to that, God was there. God. Father, Son, Spirit, Triune God. He has no beginning. So he was there before the beginning, before Genesis 1. Before what? You see the problem of sort of language, isn't it, really? God has to express things in a language we can comprehend. And so we have to think about the notion of a beginning. But in reality, God has no beginning. But yes, in his infinite wisdom, he decided, he established a plan. He was going to create a perfect universe. And I use the word universe. I'm not a scientist, and I don't understand all these different sort of solar systems and universes and things like that. Is there more than one universe? I'm not sure. But everything that exists, there came a time when God said, I'm going to create all those things. And I'll use the phrase universe for shorthand. I'm going to make them. And I'm going to make them in a way that reflects who I am. And so God made the stars, the planets, the moons, everything we know about and everything in that sense that's there that we don't know about. God made all those things to reflect what he was like. He is like. Was like and is like. So his splendor and his majesty and his incredible beauty is there in all those things that he made. And because he made not just physical, innate things, but he made living things. And so we also understand something about God from the tremendous variety of what he then created. And isn't it extraordinary when you suddenly read something, I was reading about bees, you know how many varieties of bees there are? 360-something different kinds of bees, would you believe it? I can only spot one. In this country, that is. So many kinds of bees. It's incredible. But God made, he made the elephant and the mouse. You know, he made the crocodile and the tadpole. He made the giraffe and the centipede. He made all these incredible things, all of them in the business of reflecting something about himself, his character being expressed in everything that he made. And there came the moment when God looked at all these things that he made and he said to himself, because there was no one else to talk to, it's good. I like what I've made. It is good. It is very good. But as wonderful as what everything God had made was, there was something missing. His plan was not complete. Because God wanted to create something with which he could have a relationship. And God couldn't have a can't have a relationship with an elephant or a giraffe or a centipede or a whale. And so God created Adam and Eve, the first humans, and put within them something of his own spirit in order that they may be able to choose to be his friends. And in giving them that choice to be his friends, of course, or not, he had to give them free will. He had to give them the ability to choose between right and wrong and make their own moral decisions. So God created Adam and Eve like that, putting them in charge of the world that he had made, but also putting within them the ability to choose to be his friends. Because that, for God, would be complete. And the completeness of his creation. And we know the story that in the beginning, things went well. Let's not jump immediately to the failure of it. There was a time where Adam, Eve, and God were the best of friends. And they spent a lot of time together in the Garden of Eden. They enjoyed each other's company. They really were good friends until the tragedy of Genesis 3 occurred. And I'm not going to say any more about that because actually that's going to be the basis of our study on Wednesday. But the outcome of Genesis 3, we know clearly, was that sin entered into the world, into man's heart. Man, Adam and Eve, had chosen to make the wrong moral judgment. And they'd chosen to place someone else in the most important place in their hearts. And they'd chosen to follow what Satan wanted rather than what God wanted. And so the friendship that God had with the human race was broken. God could no longer call them his friends. They could not live in that close relationship with God. They could no longer meet God in the garden and walk around with him and talk with him and chat with him and do things together as friends. Because they now carried within themselves the consequence of the choices they had made. They carried death within themselves. That was the consequence of their sin. And at that moment in history, God faced a choice. What am I going to do? As God, I could just decide to abandon my plan to have part of my creation choosing to love me and follow me and be friends with me. Or he could have decided, I'm just going to get rid of Adam and Eve and I'm going to start again. But he chose another way, didn't he? He chose a way of saying, I am going to deal with the consequences of the choice that they made. I am going to deal with the problem of death. And so at the right time, he sent his son to pay the price, that price of death. And in dying as the perfect Son of God, he defeated death. So that the human race could again be friends with God. And when we make the choice, that choice, to accept that Jesus died for the consequences of our sin, and we begin this new life that we've spoken about, we know that God gives to us his spirit. His spirit comes again within us. Spirit is in us. And one of the key reasons his spirit is within us is as a guarantee that we will inherit, we will get our inheritance from God. I'm sorry, I haven't looked at any scriptures. It's just occurred to me. So we're now going to turn to Ephesians 1 and look there. And Ephesians 1 verse 13, we read as follows. And you also were included in Christ when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. Having believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is the deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are in God's possession, to the praise of his glory. So as Christians, the reality of the Holy Spirit in our lives, one of the purposes of that is to guarantee to us that we have an inheritance that is yet to come. Okay, we have a future that is yet to come. We will, you know, inherit from God himself, God viewing us as his sons and daughters. There'll come a time when he'll say, hey, Trevor, here is your inheritance. Here is your inheritance. And the assurance I can have that, you know, that God's not kidding and God's not misleading me is that he has already given me his Spirit. And his Spirit in my life is the deposit of that inheritance. It's a guarantee of that inheritance which is to come. And we know essentially what the Bible calls that inheritance. John chapter 3, of course, we know John 3:16, don't we? For God so loved the world that he sent his only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Eternal life. And there's another great verse in John 3, verse 36, which the last verse of the chapter, which says, whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. And whoever rejects the Son will not see life. The wages of sin is death, Paul said in Romans, but the free gift of God is eternal life. Eternal life. Eternal life. It wouldn't make sense, would it, actually, in the light of the picture that I've painted in our understanding of God's plan, if our lives ceased when we physically die. That doesn't make sense. Because God's plan isn't just to have temporary friends and see them all disappear and then have some more. It is to have friends forever. And for the friendships to last forever. That was his plan with Adam and Eve, of course. And Adam and Eve would have lived forever if they hadn't made the wrong choice of Genesis 3. And God has dealt with that problem. He's dealt with the problem of physical death. And he has reinstated to his people and given us the inheritance that we will live forever. You are going to live forever. Do you realize that? You're going to live forever. That's what it means, isn't it? That's part of what it means when we say we've got eternal life. We are going to live forever. Okay? We are going to live forever. This body might die, but I am going to live forever. Paul understood the significance of this, didn't he? In 1 Corinthians 15, he says that bit about, let's read it. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 19. It says this. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, we are to be pitied more than all men. If physical death is the end of things, Paul says, as a believer, really, we're to be pitied. You know, we have a false hope. Okay, there's good things about being a Christian. There are great things about being a Christian. There are wonderful things about being a Christian. But if that all comes to a complete and absolute stop, actually, in reality, says we're to be pitied. But of course, the rest of 1 Corinthians 15 is a tremendous argument by Paul, setting out the evidence for life being forever, led by Jesus himself, rising from the dead. So we have, you know, as Christians, we are going to live forever. All right? Just really get hold of that fact this morning. Let's go back into John 14, and remind ourselves those very familiar words of Jesus. We can't look at this subject without reflecting upon these words, can we? John 14, verse 1 says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, so that you also may be where I am going. You know the way to the place where I am going." So Jesus says, there is a place. It's my Father's place, he says. It belongs to my Father. It's where my Father is. And it's where I'm going to go, and where, therefore, now Jesus is. Jesus is in the Father's place. He's in where the Father is. He's home with the Father. And one of the things he's doing there now is preparing a place for us. And how does he gloriously define that place? That place, he says, so that you may be where I am. That's the assurance. You're going to come and join me in the Father's place, says Jesus. And he says, you know how to get there. And of course, he then goes on to say, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And we thought about that over the summer. That's how we get there. We get there by having this relationship with the Lord Jesus, by following him. So our future, our ultimate destination is the Father's place. It's the Father's place. It is where Jesus is. And the greatest thing of all about it, well, is that, isn't it? Is that we go to be with him, where he is, where he is. Paul, on a number of occasions, uses a particular expression about this. We'll look at one, which is Philippians, in Philippians chapter 1. In Philippians 1, verse 21, some familiar words to us here. Philippians 1:21 says, For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I am to go on living in the body, this will mean fruitful labor for me. Yet what shall I choose? I do not know. I am torn between the two. I desire to depart and to be with Christ, which is far better. When Paul wrote this, he wasn't at the end of his life. He wasn't at this point facing, he wasn't in prison as such. He was in Rome, but he wasn't in prison. He didn't know the outcome of any of the trials against him or anything. So this wasn't him on his deathbed sort of saying this, okay? You know, knowing that in a few weeks he was going to go off and be executed. This is him, yes, at the later stages of his life, reflecting on his life and saying, hey, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain. What shall I choose? I am torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ. And that's that's a wonderful expression of heaven. That you know, that just tarries 100%, doesn't it? Tarries 100% with Jesus saying, hey, you're going to be with me. And Paul's saying, hey, the choice I've got at this moment is either I stay here or I go to be with Christ now. So let's just sort of deal with one misunderstanding that people sometimes have, and that is they think that when we die, we sort of go off to some kind of middle room and hang around for a few hundred years or 1,000 years or something in some kind of middle room with nothing to do. That's not true. Scripture's absolutely clear that as a believer, when we die, when our physical body dies, we go to be with Christ. Paul wouldn't be saying that here now, would he? If the alternative was he went and hung around for 5,000 years somewhere else. Not true. Where's Paul now? Paul is now with Christ. With Christ. Where are the 12 disciples? They're with the Jesus who said, I've gone to prepare a place for you. You'll be with me. We are with Christ. So, well, we're going to see from some more verses. Not sure, have I used the word so far? Heaven, okay? That's the word that is used most commonly in Scripture to describe this place where Jesus is. Okay? It is heaven. And I rightly point upwards, and we rightly think upwards because it's obviously not downwards. It is upwards in that sense, okay? When Jesus ascended to heaven, he went upwards, didn't he? Okay? He didn't go downwards, he went upwards. So on that basis, we can always think of it as upwards, okay? In a physical sense, because it's not a physical reality in the same sense as we understand physical at the moment, and that would be an issue we'll probably explore in a few weeks to come. But I just want to reflect on some verses and think about, answer this question, what are we going to do in heaven? Okay? Some people love to, you know, cynics and those who mock paint the picture that we'll sit on clouds and play harps and do things like that. So let's have a little look and answer the question, what we do in heaven. And as I said earlier, we can't sort of turn to one section of the Bible and say they're all the answers. We get some clues by moving around some different verses. So we are going to look at, I think, 6 verses in total. But let me just make the one overwhelming point that, of course, we, in being with Christ in heaven, that is the fulfillment of who we are. That is the fulfillment of why God has made us and chose us in the first place. And so the greatest thing about heaven is just that we are with, as Paul said, with Christ. Well, Jesus himself said, you are going to be with me. Okay? So, you know, when we love someone, we like to be with them. And that's what it's going to be like in heaven. We're going to be with the Jesus that we love. And that is the greatest thing I can say about it, without a doubt. And that's why Paul, you know, talked the way he did here in Philippians 1. That's what marked it out for him. My choice was stay here or be with Christ. Oh, my word, that's better to be with him, he said. That would be my gain. That was his greatest anticipation about dying, was that just that he would be with Jesus. He'd be with Jesus. So I hope you and I, we have that anticipation. We have that. You know, I'll use the word hope, but of course we use that word in a definite sense, not in a speculative sense. We have that assured hope that we will be with Jesus, the Jesus that we love, the Jesus that we have served and followed. We will have fellowship with Jesus, friendship with Jesus. That was his plan, God's plan in the beginning, that he would have people who would be his friends. When Jesus was in the upper room with the disciples, there came the point he was teaching various things prior to the cross, and he said, hey, from now on, you're not servants any longer. I'm now going to call you friends. That was the greatest thing in some ways that he said to them. Because that's the yearning of God, is to have people who are his friends. And the fulfillment of our friendship with God is being with him in heaven. So you know, that's the greatest thing about being in heaven. But let's get an insight from some more verses about other things, because we don't then just sit around and do nothing, okay, and stare at each other, okay? Things go on. Matthew 8, for example, is a verse which indicates a few things to us. Matthew 8, 11. It says this, I say to you that many will come from the east and the west, and they will take their places at the feast with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. So, when we get there, we're going to meet Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. We're going to meet the Old Testament saints. We're going to meet the New Testament saints. We're going to meet anyone. There's the potential to meet anyone who has loved the Lord Jesus and is there in heaven, okay? You know, so this and other verses, I mean, we don't become amorphous people and not recognize for who we are. We are known as who we are. We'll know who Moses is. You know, we'll know who Isaac is. We'll know who Peter is. We'll know who Martin Luther is. You know, we are who we are. We carry ourselves and our characters in that sense into heaven. And we'll have the opportunity to meet these characters. We've got eternity to do it, so there's plenty of time. So if you particularly want to meet Moses, you know, you can keep asking until you find Moses. He's the one you're looking to meet. And of course, we can then have a conversation. We can have a conversation with, you know, if you're sitting down at a feast next to someone, you can have a conversation with them, can't you? And you can chat to Moses and you can ask him whatever you want to ask him, and so on and so forth. So we are going to meet and greet and be with not just Jesus, but all those who are friends of God. All those who are friends of God. And this verse also tells us, of course, that part of the context in which we're going to meet is it's part of heaven. There's going to be an experience in heaven. These things we're going to look at, they're not necessarily all happening sort of necessarily at the same time or all the time, but there is going to be a great feast. Being in heaven is going to be like being at a big, big feast. And we all like food. We all like eating. It's going to be a really pleasurable experience, being in heaven. It's going to be a great thing. It's going to be a great celebration in heaven. Matthew 25 tells us a bit more. We're going to read a little bit of one of the parables. So there are many parables, of course, about heaven that give us insights into aspects of it. But just picking on one, which is one we know well, I think, anyway. Matthew 25, this is the parable of the talents. Matthew 25, verse 21 says, his master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come. Come and share your master's happiness. So two things we learn from that verse. First of all, is that the master's happy in heaven. God is happy in heaven, okay? Heaven is a place of happiness. It's not a place of long faces. It's not a place of... It's a happy place, okay? God is happy there. Really happy. It's a good place. It's a place of smiles. It's a place of laughter. It's a place of joy. It's a place of fun. That's heaven. God is all those things, and I'm sure we're going to be those things as well. And, of course, as this verse also says to us, it's a place of service. Because in that verse, the Master God says to the servant, I will put you in charge of many things. You've got work to do for me, God says. Come to my place of happiness and do some work for me. Do some work for me. And you know what work God's going to give us? He's going to give us the work that perfectly fits who we are. No longer are we going to find ourselves in a stressful job that we don't want. No longer are we going to find ourselves anxious about work. Work is going to be an absolute delight and pleasure because it's the work that God has chosen for each one of us and equipped us to do, and that we delight to do it in order to please him in the context of being in this place of happiness. So we are going to serve God. We are going to work for him in heaven. Okay? Luke 23. This might, in your mind, these things might be causing all kinds of sort of questions to arise. That's fine. Go home, think about them, revisit scriptures. Luke 23, verse 43. Ah, yes, another famous verse, isn't it? So here's Jesus on the cross, and the dying thief turns to him and says in verse 42, "Remember me, Jesus, when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus answered him, "I tell you the truth, today you will be with me in paradise." Again, this picks an earlier point about the immediacy, but the point I mostly want to pick up is that Jesus uses the word paradise. Okay, the word paradise. And it was the secular word for a wonderful, beautiful garden. Or park, really. Well, I suppose we would more say a park, perhaps. Just a really beautiful outdoor place. And Jesus says to the dying thief, "You're going to be with me today in this wonderfully beautiful place." So heaven itself is a beautiful place, let alone everything else God has made. But you know, it's a beautiful place that we're going to go to. Okay? And I'm sure we're all going to have a real sense of, wow, look at this place. This is fantastic. This is amazing. I just can't believe it. You know, it's incredible. This is a wonderful place. A wonderful place. There was an occasion, this word paradise, I think, is only used once more in the New Testament. Paul used it when he was describing to the church at Corinth the experience he had, and he wasn't sure whether he was having a vision or it really happened. And he says, "I was lifted up into the highest," and he says, "paradise. There I saw God," he said. Paradise. You know, whatever that word, we tend to think of that word now, don't we? It really, in English, it tends to mean this, you know, the perfect place, doesn't it? That's right. That's right. That's right. That's where God is. He's in the perfect place. 1 Corinthians 13. Again, very familiar words we use, but don't usually. It's a great chapter about love, but don't normally draw this aspect from the verses. 1 Corinthians 13, verse 12. Says, "Now we see but a poor reflection, as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now we know in part. Then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known." A mirror at this time, of course, would not have been a glass mirror. Mirrors were metal. They were polished metal. So you certainly didn't get a perfect image of yourself, would you, if you looked at some polished metal? Okay, you know, your outline would be there, but you couldn't really put your lipstick on very carefully and things like that, just on a polished piece of metal. So the mirror was not perfect. Yet Paul, of course, is saying is, now we don't see things clearly, we don't understand them clearly, but there one day we will. We will see clearly, and we will know fully, says Paul. We will understand fully. Because he's speaking about when we are in God's presence. There'll come a time when we will fully understand and know how much God loves us. We'll fully understand what our sin really meant to Jesus. We'll fully understand the price he paid. We'll fully understand the grace and the mercy that he's shown us as we've falteringly lived the Christian life. We'll fully understand really just who God is when we get to heaven. At this stage, it's dim. It's not clear. What we only know in part, but then we will know in its completeness and its fullness. That's partly exactly why we can't at this point in time, of course, know fully, therefore, what heaven is like. We don't have the language, we don't have the concepts. It's not possible, whilst we are constrained in a human body, for us to fully understand. But when we are there, we will understand. And we will understand who God is and what he's like. And one last verse in Revelation 5 as to what we will do when we get there. Well, it ties in actually with what's going on now. We'll join in what's going now on this, in relation to this particular verse. Revelation 5, verse 13. John, isn't it? And he's having a glimpse into heaven. And he says, "Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and sea and all that is in them singing to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb, be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever." Paul heard every creature who is in heaven singing and praising glory to God. What's happening in heaven right now? There's every creature in heaven right now is singing praise and glory to God. That's what's happening this morning. We've just joined in with heaven this morning, really. That's what his people are doing around the world this day. They're joining in with what's going on in heaven. Because in heaven, 24/7, they are singing the praises of God. Every creature there, every saint there, is singing God's praise. Whenever people caught a glimpse into heaven, their response was always to fall down and to worship God. That was true just of every character. Who came across the resurrected Jesus, of course, they did the same, didn't they? Mary did the same. Thomas did the same. Whenever they got a glimpse of Jesus as risen, and the greatest and clearest example of that was John himself, here in John 1. When he caught a little glimpse of what's going on in heaven, his reaction was just to fall down in amazement and worship. And I want to finish then just by reading from Revelation 1, verse 12. And say to you, this is the Jesus you and I are going to meet. This is what he's going to look like, or the nearest that it could be put into human language that he's going to look like when we see him. Revelation 1:12 says, "Then I turned round to see the voice that was speaking to me. And when I turned, I saw seven golden lampstands, and among the seven lampstands was someone like a son of man, dressed in a robe reaching down to his feet, and with a golden sash round his chest. His head and hair were like white wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were like blazing fire. His feet were like bronze glowing in a furnace, and his voice was like the sound of rushing waters. In his right hand he held out seven stars, and out of his mouth came a sharp double-edged sword. His face was like the sun, shining in all its brilliance. And when I saw him, I fell down at his feet, as though dead." This is the Jesus one day we're going to see. This is what he's going to be like when we see him. I don't know what we're going to be like. We're going to be changed, of course. We are going to be changed. But this is what Jesus is going to be like. Heaven is going to be far, far greater than we can imagine, isn't it? Jesus is going to be far more wonderful than we can imagine. God is going to be far, far greater than we can conceive of, as much as we stretch our minds and our hearts. But that Jesus says, this is our inheritance. This is our inheritance. If you have the Son, Jesus said, you have life. If you believe in him, we have eternal life. And the culmination of our eternal life, which we have begun now, is that we enter into the presence to be with Jesus, to be with Christ. No wonder, no wonder Jesus said to his disciples, don't let your hearts be troubled. Don't be anxious. Don't worry. Don't be burdened. Don't let the cares that you have weigh you down. Because I'm going to prepare a place for you. And one day you will be with me in that place. Hallelujah. Praise God, what he has in store for each one of us who love him. Let's pray together. Father, this morning we just want to worship you and adore you and acknowledge how great you are. Because of your plan from before time began, that you might have people who are your friends, who you live with forever. And here, Lord, we are in 2021 in Canning Town, and you've called us to be part of this plan. Lord, this is humanly crazy. Lord, it is spiritually extraordinary. It is amazingly wonderful that you've called each one of us to be part of your plan, to be one of your friends, to live with you forever. Lord, forgive us for the times that we let our troubles dominate our thinking and our hearts. Forgive us for the times we allow those things to weigh us down. For Lord, this morning you have lifted our hearts and we are looking to you, the Son of Man, the Exalted One, the Risen One, Glorified One, the One whose name is above every name. And we bow our knee before you and worship and praise you this morning for all that you have in store for us. And Lord, this morning we would say to you, yes, Lord, we trust in you. We believe in you. Thank you for the life, the eternal life that you have given us. Thank you. Thank you, thank you, Lord. In the most worthy name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. We're going to sing to close. We'll go outside and do it. That great song, How Great Thou Art. How Great Thou Art. And that last verse, of course, talks about when Christ shall come. And so on, which may be a subject for future weeks, but let's just enjoy singing our closing song together outside. I'll send it round.